Since I haven't got you guys caught up on my racing journey since really last September, let's recap. The last two rounds of the Colorado Karting Tour's 2020 season was a doubleheader at action. On Saturday was the small track, like basically a kid kart track, and then Sunday was the full track. So on Saturday, I was feeling pretty good, but I really struggled with the motor and gearing all through the weekend. It was a big struggle. Then came the final. The final, I was doing pretty good. I was holding second for a while, and then I got caught up in some Micromax traffic, which slowed me down a bit, and there was the two micros were battling, and so me and the 105 were also battling for second place, and we had to split the Micromax guys, and I went to the outside, the 105 went to the inside, and he had the inside line, so I lost that position. But after the race in Tech, I even got a DQ for running the wrong header. On Sunday, I was also really struggling to get the gear right, and because it was literally the next day and we had to change the whole track. And it was a big struggle getting the right gearing and like warm up and also tuning the engine because it was a different day, you know, different conditions. So in the final, I started fourth, but I moved my way up to second pretty quickly and was chasing down the leader. And once I got the leader in my sights, it was a combination of just me hitting the curb too hard and the chain being a little too tight, and my chain threw and I had to go off track, and that was the end of my race.
Thank you.
As you can see here, we're in a brand new shop slash studio, and we built this all ourselves, and it took a couple months to build, but I'm very proud of it. It's very organized, and I love it. And let me know down in the comments below what you think about our new shop and studio. Be sure to go check out our latest video with Eric from Point Karting. We give you tips and tricks to get your kart set up. Some of you who follow me know that I got a sim and started iRacing for the first time last April. And since then, I've been getting really serious about it. I even joined a professional iRacing team, the Deltasport Juniors. Link for them below. I started racing the Colorado Karting Tour iRacing Winter Series last November. Check out the highlights from Lime Rock and the Charlotte Oval Race, which was surprisingly fun.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to the Colorado Karting Tour Winter Series Round 1 at Lime Rock Park, historic racetrack in Connecticut, as we jump back now to Cadence Presley in fourth place, just now on an outlap after his unceremonious crash coming up through the uphill chicane. So he's had a couple of quick sectors there, so we'll have to watch his time, see if he can jump Hubrex for the pole as it stands. Looks like he's the only driver currently on track at the moment. Everyone else has reset to the pits, it seems, or is between laps, perhaps. As we get a nice...
I was going to say, Cadence in the top five in qualifying as well. He was hovering on the back end of the top five at the at Laguna Seca last time out. So it's great to see him, you know, really getting to grips with the car again. He's sort of adjusting himself in. And remember, he's only 10 years old. He's the youngest driver in this entire field.
Absolutely,
and,
yeah.
That Cadence is impressive how fast he is currently.
Jim McKendry will start third alongside Cadence Presley, 10 years old, starting in fourth place. How about that? Try to make it stick.
Hubrex and Presley side by side as they make their way towards the chicane. The onus is on the faster car to make the move.
Absolutely.
Again, all drivers did agree that coming out the corner, they're just going to hold their line. So,
really helpful. That and oh no! Oh, that's a shame for Cadence. That's
the second time in two races that's happened to Cadence now where he's gotten close.
Oh my god, that's the leaders! That's both of them.
And that's Kenny Schmied out.
But it's all going right for Rob Hubrex at the moment as he has assumed a 2.5 second lead now over Jim McKendry, who's quickly being caught by Cadence Presley for second place. So, as I was saying before, we mentioned about the iRacing damage model handling. The way it works is what we see is not necessarily what the overarching iRacing server sees. So it wasn't a matter of Cadence Presley's wheels falling off and being repaired. It was a matter of they never were actually damaged in the first place. It's just one of our client iRacing views predicted that it would be, and then it turned out it wasn't on the server side. So that's what that was.
Which is always helpful.
Yes.
To say the least. Again, Cadence Presley through, she said though, and great to see. He's actually only 3 seconds off the back of Rob Hubrex now. And, well, if Rob makes another mistake, could see Cadence Presley leading this race. Again, we've only got a minute to go, so this is going to be the final lap.
Over.
Yeah, well done to Rob, as Cadence Presley will stand atop the second step of the podium.
Ooh, that was awesome. Heck yeah!
Good job, bud.
Woo, that was awesome. Yes! I am so happy. You know, last time I didn't start the way I wanted. But now I have the chance. I can win this race. Rob, be prepared, Rob.
Alright, so...
We talk to race number one, runner-up Cadence Presley. I think that would be...
Yeah, I think it would be an idea. We were meant to get him in last time, so what we'll do is we'll drag him in this time. Cadence! Hello,
hey, how's it going?
Yeah, it's good to see you, my friend. So, race one went extremely well, actually. Runner-up and really good pace, especially shown in qualifying. And then race two didn't exactly go the way we thought it would for you. What happened?
No. I was just pushing it a little too hard. And
I couldn't fix myself for a while, and I came out of the pits that one time and just flew back off track and just grazed the wall, which just messed up my tire, and it didn't really go that well, but I definitely tried my hardest.
Well, for sure. We saw your pace, certainly, in qualifying in race number one. A much cleaner race, I think, for you, pretty much faultless. Do you think you could keep up with the big guns there, Rob and Kenny and Jim? Do you think you had the pace for them in race two if things had gone a little bit better?
Yes, I definitely think I would. I can keep up the pace, and if I can just have a little bit more luck and a bit more skill not flying off track, then I could definitely keep up with them.
Absolutely, Caden. I mean, we've talked about it a bit on the broadcast, but your skill for what you're doing at your age is something that we could not have done. So we're both super impressed with the performances you've been putting on. Obviously, everyone's going to have some bad days, some bad races. So are you looking forward to the next race? Have you raced around Okayama on iRacing?
I actually didn't know it was Okayama, but I am very excited, and I've actually been racing in some actual iRacing races at that track a lot lately, so I think I'll be pretty competitive, and I think I can shoot for a win there.
Oh, perfect, Cadence. Awesome. Do you have anyone you'd like to thank before we let you go tonight?
Well, first of all, I'd like to thank my dad for getting me this entire sim and letting me get on iRacing, because it's been a lot of money and a lot of racing money to get this. And I'd like to thank everyone in CKT for having a good time and being polite and helpful and having a good time with me.
Awesome. Thank you, Cadence.
Your
race number one runner-up, Cadence Presley. Probably the most impressive 10-year-old that I can think of.
These drivers have good racecraft, but we have another opportunity for a restart. That beautiful FR 500 Mustang is going to come down pit road and get ready to go green.
It's a late move. I think it caught you off guard there.
Oh, come no.
It looked like he wasn't going to duck down, but Cadence, perhaps playing the smart role there, waited for Brian to go and ducked in right in front of Kenny Schmied. Kenny now looking to the outside, so he's going to try and do what Cadence and Brian were able to do to him. He's got the help of de facto teammate Jim McKendry there. He is, oh, and they are three wide now for the lead. So Kenny doing exactly what he saw done to him on the previous restart and trying to make it work around the outside. Cadence has cleared Brian. So Bruzzi settles into third place on track, but he's going to get the run on Kenny out of turn number four. They are side by side for second, but at the moment it is Cadence Presley who stands alone and leads that lap number nine. Kenny now alongside him as they head into turn number one, but you would expect him to lose a little bit of ground here through the corner just by virtue of him taking the longer line. He's got, I believe, Floyd Kerr. Yes, it is Floyd lined up behind him. Jim McKendry has settled back into the inside line. Brian was looking to the middle there to make it three wide, but there really wasn't room, and he wisely settles back into that third, or rather second place on the inside line, side by side with Floyd Kerr. They're two by two and nearly side to side contact there as Cadence kind of ran just a little bit wide out of that corner, and Kenny did well to avoid him. But Kenny Schmied hanging on just a bit around the outside, certainly not giving up any ground to Cadence. It seems that we've just kind of formed our parade lines, and they're going to hang like this for a little bit.
Yeah, that parade line is set. We'll see if they're able to keep that train a chugging. We got three wide. We'll see from the beautiful camera on the roll bar. I love when we go on board, be able to see from that driver's eye, and you'll see how quick they have to react. It's a great thing.
Yeah, I believe that was Rob Hubrex trying to make the move happen around the outside on board here with Jim McKendry. Rob, as mentioned, winner of all four of the races heading into this round, obviously did not win race number one. So he is no longer undefeated here this season, but he is trying to make that third line work, and he's got a run now on Floyd Kerr and is currently shown in third place, but I think he'll drop back a little bit here, and it'll force him three wide with Tyler Green and Jim McKendry, who is doing everything he can to stay as low as possible, because if he doesn't, there's going to be some trouble, I think. But he did well to manage that, as Floyd Kerr nearly came together with Kenny Schmied, but it pulled Jim McHenry right along up into fifth place, battling for fourth with Floyd Kerr.
Now, when you're that car in the third line or way on the three wide, you're just hoping those cars at the bottom kind of get shaken up a little bit, to lost momentum. Oh, looks like...
Oh, my goodness.
Presley.
How did...
Brutzy, that... Presley all around.
Yeah, that was nearly a massive wreck, because Brutzy was three wide with Presley and Kerr somehow. And only by virtue of him backing out did they not have a massive pile up there, because that would have been pretty much the whole field, I have to believe. Instead, they are two by two by two. Kenny Schmied alongside Cadence Presley, behind them Floyd Kerr and Brian Brutzy. Now it's Tyler Green trying to make that third line work. We saw Rob Hubrex attempt it and not able to make ground at all. It looks like Green will find a similar fate here, and Daniel Lopez is coming along quickly to try and fill that gap and trap Tyler Green on the outside.
Not still side by side for lead, so.
Yes, yeah. Not really anywhere for these drivers to go. You know, it's not like one of these drivers up front can pull a massive advantage. And it really seems like the tow only manages to take you alongside, so you need to somehow force the car that you're racing with to get out of the gas to get any sort of advantage, for whatever reason. And we have seen it happen, but at the moment, if you can hold your line and stay in the gas, you're going to be in good shape here. As they were three wide briefly for the lead, Floyd Kerr trying to make it work this time. It's yet another driver making that third line their home. Green has settled back into the inside line, and it looks like he might actually pick up the place that Floyd Kerr was holding in that kind of third battle for third and fourth. Just a little side-by-side contact. I think Brutzy caught the apron and came up into Green just a bit. Now they're three wide. Oh, Cadence is on the apron there. Oh, and there it is. Oh, you saw that coming, didn't you?
Oh, you hate to see it. Lopez, Kerr, McHenry, we stay green.
Oh, yeah, good. Caution, no, they're yellow. Yep, yeah. Bit of a late yellow, but yeah, it just looked to me like Cadence was on the apron. I think Kenny thought he was clear. And sometimes if the car you're racing with gets far enough on the apron, well, actually, it looked to me like Kenny was clear, and there was just a little bit of net code there that forced him into Cadence. And unfortunately, Cadence got sent further onto the apron, which in turn sent his car back up the track. Here is the... Ooh, gosh, it's close. Yeah, I can see why Kenny might have thought he was clear, but unfortunately he was not. And that contact with Cadence collected quite a few drivers. I hear Cadence apologizing in the chat, but I think he might watch that back and realize it wasn't really his fault.
Oh, it's always good to get an apology out, even if you don't know if it's yours or the other driver's fault.
You're absolutely right. It is always good to get an apology when you can, as we get a nice slow motion shot of that new damage model. For those unaware, Cadence is 10 years old, a junior kart racer, and from everything we've heard when talking to him in the interview room, a absolutely fantastic kid. So no surprise that he's apologized here.